when I found out about being asked to do the future music piece, I kind of put the feelers out on Twitter to find out what you guys wanted to see about how I did in some of my tracks. And so I'm going to go through a few different elements of different tracks. The first one is my track Rocket, which was out on Tool Room a couple of months ago. So that is this. And basically what I'm going to do is go through how I made the lead sound in this. Which is this part here. And I mean, most of my sounds in a lot of my tracks, especially ones like this, are quite sort of acidic-y and sort of aggressive sounding. The main leads are normally made from like very, very sort of simple sounds. So, I mean, this sound originally, before any of the processing, is just this, which is just a real simple, it's just a saw, basically, off the Arturia Mini Moog, which I use quite a lot for things. And yeah, the actual sound itself is really made up with, like I say, with the processing afterwards, which involves sort of a lot of different distortions and EQs and a few other things to kind of make the sound sort of a lot wider and bigger sounding, really. So, first thing I use on it is Isotope Trash, which is a distortion unit. There's a couple of these on it. This is the first one, which is changed it to that. I mean, it's kind of adding like quite a big EQ spike to give it that sort of throaty sort of sound. Next, there's a bit of a bit crusher on it to give it a bit sort of more sparkle on the top end. And then the main one that really changes it is another Isotope Trash, which takes it from that to that, which obviously is quite extreme. And then it's just a few other parts to sort of widen up the sound a little bit. First of all is Isotope Ozone, which I'm using the stereo imager on that to just kind of bring out some of the frequencies. I mean, the good thing about this ozone thing is that it actually splits the signal into separate frequencies, so you can apply the effects just on one frequency. So I'm just applying it on this band here, which is just kind of the top end. Basically what it's doing is it's using a stereo, it's using like a stereo delay basically to kind of make the sound wide, like a sample delay. So yeah, if I turn it off, I don't know if you're going to pick this up on here or not, but it just kind of opens the top of the sound out a little bit, really. So there's that. Then there's another Isotope Ozone, which is, I'm using the EQ on this, basically. So obviously you normally get your stereo EQs, but you can also get EQs that work on a mid-side sort of basis. So what that does, it splits up the mono signal in the middle from the stereo information. And so that's just the stereo information coming from it. So what I've done is I've just boosted the top EQ on just the stereo part of the file, again to make the sort of top end out even wider, really. So that kind of takes it to that. And then there's just a couple more EQs. I mean, I EQ stuff quite heavily, as you can see. I don't really use like particularly advanced EQs. It's just the normal EQ that comes with Cubase 4, which is what I'm still on, basically. So I use quite heavy EQ. You see I'm boosting quite heavily in quite a lot of areas. And again, with this one here, same sort of thing. So the Isotope Trash thing, obviously it's a distortion unit, but also has like a delay feature on it, which is kind of giving that sort of that whippy sort of sound to it. This is it without the delay part on. And then when I turn it on, you see it obviously sort of brings that in. And that part's quite wide, so obviously when I boosted the wide signal, it sort of brought that out a lot more as well, sort of brightened it up quite a lot. So yeah, I mean, that's kind of how that sound's made up. I mean, like I say, one of the main things about these sounds that I use a lot is the basic sound is just a very simple sound, you know what I mean? Like just a very simple saw, and it's all about that post sort of processing and distortions to give it the sort of sound and the identity sort of thing. For my Tom Staar stuff that I do, I pretty much always use the same kick near enough. I've got a good one that I know works well, and I always start with that. Often applying sort of different EQs to it again to kind of make it sort of cut through the mix. And the bass itself, the sub, is off the Mini Moog again, actually. Again, just a really simple sound. I think it's just a saw again, really, with a bit of filter sort of on it.
So what do you think makes a good kick?
I think it's got to have quite a few different elements. I mean, obviously the attack on it, the transient on it's really important, and really kind of trying to keep that coming through. I mean, keeping other sounds away from that transient so that you really get that punch sort of come through sort of thing. Obviously, one of the main things you use for that is like a side chain. So I mean, both the bass and that lead are both running through into a group side chain basically, which is triggered by just like a short version of the kick, just the start of the kick. So that just ducks it down really quickly when that transient hits sort of thing. And that's kind of one of the most important things about getting that the front of that kick to come through and really poke through is just having a real tight side chain on it and just getting that transient to really poke through.
And where do you stand on sort of EQing the kick against the bass? Do you keep it quite light or?
I just kind of work on the EQ of both of them as I'm sort of working along really. I mean it's important to have them sort of balanced, and obviously in order to have them balanced sort of frequency wise they need that side chain to keep them away from each other, because that's they kind of distort and just the kick doesn't come through very well basically. Okay, like another little secret that I've got that I do on pretty much all my Tom Staar music, especially with the kick, is a way to just kind of get it punching through a little bit. Is I don't quite know how I came across it, but basically what I do is I have a little bit of white noise, you see, this here, and I sit that just in front of where the kick is, basically. And yeah, that's without it on. And then when you put it on, for some reason it just kind of gives it a little bit more thump, and it just kind of cuts through a little bit better. I don't really know why, I don't really know how I found it out. But it just seems to add a bit of thump. I think the transient of the kick kind of comes through a little bit better sort of thing.
Is that white noise EQ'd or is it just full signal?
It's just a bounce of just a solid white noise basically with a little tiny volume envelope on it. Like I say, literally just hits just for the kick. I mean, there's just like a little bit of top on it.
There's no low end on that white noise at all though, is it really?
Probably, well, hang on a second, let me just have a look at it properly a minute. There might be a little bit. I mean, it's just an audio bounce off some white noise that I had. It's not EQ'd that heavily, really. I mean, there's still quite a lot of mid and stuff in it, really. It's not. Yeah, but I mean, it's so small, you don't really pick that up, really. It just kind of helps to get the front of that kick through for some reason. It kind of helps it sort of cut through the mix a little bit as well. So that's one thing that I do that is a bit of a secret. I wasn't sure about whether to tell people that, but I have done that. So other parts of this, I think probably what I'll do is go into the automation on this lead, because I mean this track is kind of, it's all about the builds really, and so just find start. Basically the main sort of thing about the track is this lead going from that all the way up to when it kicks in into that basically. So the severe kind of distortion that I had on it, I've basically got wet and dry on it on trash, and so I've got an automation going from the wet, obviously when it kicks in, well no, from the dry to the wet when it kicks in basically. So that's automated coming up over this like long period sort of thing for the build. Along with the delay part that we said, that's kind of rising up as well. I mean, it's kind of made up of numerous things just sort of opening up. I mean, the sound itself on the synth doesn't actually really move until right near the end of the build, and it's all just about the wet dry of the distortion signal coming through to help it build up sort of thing really. So I mean obviously with that there's also a load of rises and stuff that are sort of coming up with it. I mean there's loads of different rises, a couple of audio bounces from other projects that I've done. This was off my Paper Aeroplane remix, just a bounce out of one of the rises from that. So there's that. There's white noise on a bandpass filter, which is what I kind of use for my sort of like wind sort of rise sort of things. I mean, it's that same white noise sample that I was showing you earlier that I used on the kick. And on that, I've just got a tonic, which is just the old standard filter from Cubase on a bandpass, and basically automating the cutoff. So it goes from there and sort of rises up to give that sort of intense sort of building sort of thing. So there's that. Then there's also another rise, which a second. Yeah, I think this is made in massive. With a load of plugins on it, a load of distortion and stuff. I mean, the original sound is really quiet by the sounds of things. Yeah, this is the original sound coming up. Again, it's got a distortion, one called Homicide that I also use quite a lot. I mean, it works the same way as trash. It kind of splits it into different bands, so you can have different amounts of distortion on different sort of bands in the frequency range. So there's that, and then also a lot of stuff sort of on the beat as well, to kind of just building up on top of that as well. Just different layers. I mean, you've got the claps, a couple of different claps, smacker, which is just looks like it's just a sample that running out of contact. Yeah, just kind of a drum sort of white. No, it's a snare actually pitched down. And then also another contact, just running a sample, just out of a sample CD of some sort of low end sort of thing, really. So just kind of give it that thud, especially in the club as well. That really sort of helps kind of build it, just gives it a bit of sort of intensity. So there's all that going, everything opening up. And then another thing I do is I have quite a lot, especially for my build-ups and stuff, is I have quite a few effects actually on the master out. First of all, one of the things I do on pretty much every track in the builds is have a reverb basically on the master out, and as it's building up over this period, the reverb will sort of build up with it, sort of thing, you know, to kind of just add that sort of intenseness and that sort of like, yeah, just intensity really. So along with that, there's also Sonox EQ, which is it's on the, again on the master out, it's just kind of knocking the bottom end off the whole track really as it's going up, and just getting thinner and thinner, so that when it does drop, obviously that just completely turns off. So you get that impact sort of thing, and the bottom end all comes in then. And as well as that, I also quite often, because obviously with all the things opening up, with the distortion, everything all opening up, it starts getting really loud. So I also have automation on my main output as well, with the volume coming down, which then snaps back up again when it kicks in.
On the master fader?
On the master, yeah. Yeah, that's right, yeah. I mean, for my build, it's the things I have on my master are really important, just for giving it that sort of bigness, and yeah, just helping it sort of rise really.
And where do you stand when it drops? What do you leave over? Like, do you have white noise?
I mean, it varies on the track really. I mean, this it cuts really dead. Nothing carries over at all. It's all about that contrast between everything being open and just really noisy to like to sort of really tight and really dry sort of thing. Right. Yeah, everything just cuts there. There's no white noise or anything. I mean, the white noise I kind of use on a lot of tracks to give it that. Because obviously when it's building, you've got a lot of top frequencies in there. So often I put the white noise in to kind of, so it doesn't come sort of too dull, you know, the contrast isn't too much. But on this, because there's so much top end and sort of crackle on that lead sound, you don't really need it, I don't think. You kind of get that the top end from that, so it's not really needed on this. So yeah, I mean, that's, like I said, the track is all about that really. There's not really a lot else to it. There's a few drum loops that come in to kind of pick it up, to just, they're just loops out of a sample CD or something, which I've kind of layered up and put in there. And they come in and pick it up here. And then again, it's all about it building again, really. So it's just all the rides and everything are back in there, and it's just building that intensity. It's all about sort of the intensity on this track, so.
And what about other master channel plugins? Do you have like go-to ones for keeping the mix in check?
Yeah, I mean, what I tend to do, because I mean, I used to quite a lot have trouble where, because I tend not to cut. I know normally you should, the people always say you should be cutting EQs rather than adding, but I tend to have got a frequency to just add shitloads of EQ. I can swear, can't I?
Yeah.
Yeah, I just tend to add loads and loads of EQs, and so I used to always have a problem where eventually I'd get so far through a track and been piling all the sounds in, and eventually all my faders would be up really high, and it would just be an absolute nightmare, especially once I got automation in and stuff. And so what I do now is I have all my channels, when I start off, I had all my channels running like really, really low. I mean, on this they've kind of crept up. I mean, this is quite high for me. Like, when I'll start off, my kick and that will literally be like really low on my channels, and then what I do is I have PSV Vintage Warmer like cranked right up as high as it can go basically to give me the signal, and then as I'm building stuff in and EQing stuff, I'll gradually pull that down sort of thing, so it leaves me with plenty of headroom, so I never end up in a situation where I'm having to like pull everything down and like mess with my mix up sort of thing. So that's one thing that I do that most people probably don't. I definitely have all my faders and all my channels running really low normally. Master out, yeah, I just have the Vintage Warmer on there. Obviously I've got the plugins that I was saying that I use for my sort of builds and my effects and stuff, which are all automated. And then on this one, I've also got another ozone, which again is I'm using for the mid-side EQ on it. So it's kind of using doing the same thing again, just to really bring out that brightness on that lead and everything. So this like the side signal, the stereo signal, obviously is that, and I've just boosted that again even more. The same sort of thing as what the other one was doing, really, just to add more and more brightness to it, really. And then I've also cut the bottom end off that stereo signal so that all the bass is obviously just sort of in the middle in mono, which is what you always want for that sort of solidness. And I mean, that's about it for this track, really. I mean, it's all just about that, all about them builds and the stuff opening up and the automation, really. So cool. So the next thing I want to talk about is kind of layering up sounds, which is also really important on a lot of my stuff. And the track I'm going to show you is mine and Kryder's remix of Swedish House Mafia, Don't You Worry Child, from probably a couple of years ago now. But I mean, it sort of is a good example of layering sounds and that really to come to a sort of a finished sort of sound. Now, we had sent all the parts separately, all the stems, so we had the riff as audio, we had the MIDI for the riff, all the vocals and everything. Went through loads of different ideas for it, trying with parts of the riff and chords and stuff, and eventually all we actually used was the vocal. So basically, this is it. So I'm just going to mute a couple of white noises and stuff, so got a bit more, you can hear it a bit easier. Now, first of all, Chris Kryder, he came up with this line at his place at home. Came down here with the audio of it. When he'd written it, his like sort of sketch that he did for this sort of idea, I think it actually had swing on it. And we decided that we didn't want, I chopped it up so I could take the swing off it by the looks of things. So it was just straighter and just more sort of driving, really, rather than too much groove. So I mean, the pattern itself's got quite a lot of sort of groove to it anyway. And so we wanted to keep it sort of a bit more banging as well. So we straightened that all out. I basically went in, had audio of the riff. Might have it here somewhere. So it was originally just like that, and then I kind of went in and just chopped all the hits basically, and just like straightened it all out. And then I basically began layering up, because we wanted the sound to be really big. We knew the melody was cool and had plenty of drive and stuff, but we wanted the sound to be a lot bigger and just have a lot more impact to it. So started layering up sounds with it. First of all, there was something off Massive, which is this we used. Just turn off some of the plugins on it. So again, it was a really simple sound that's coming out of Massive. It's just that, but the sound, it's kind of made up again, and the sort of the main sort of body of the sound is kind of made up with distortion and stuff again, really. So Homicide this time I used on it. Some EQs to kind of thin it out. Bit Crusher again to give it that sort of sparkle at the top. And then something called the Envelope Shaper, which I use quite a lot, which is sort of really good for getting the transients and sort of the attack of things a lot better. Obviously like how you would do with a compressor sometimes, but this is really good because you get a nice sort of readout of what it's actually doing to it. So I don't know how well you're going to pick this up, but if you listen to the transients on it, basically what you can do is with the attack, you can actually just, it kind of works like a volume thing on the sound. So if I put up the attack, you can actually put up the transient of the sound, you can actually increase without the volume of the rest of the sound. So that's like a really extreme version of it. So I had a little bit of that on it to give it a little bit more sort of snap. So that was the first sound. And then there's this like knocky sort of sound, which originally was just, I think it's just a bongo sound, which we had in Contact. Yeah, I mean, these are all, both these sounds are going through a group channel with the delays and all that sort of stuff on. So you can hear all the delays and everything on it already. And so Sony Oxford EQ knocking probably the bottom end off. Yeah, knocking the bottom end off. Another EQ doing nothing. And then the main EQ, again, just knocking out sort of the 200, 100 hertz, just to give it a bit of space at the bottom end. And yeah, that's grouped together with that, with the acid sound, to give you one part of it. And then obviously layer that up with Chris's original sound. So it starts to get a bit more body now. So yeah, that's three sounds basically, all playing the same riff. And then, what did I do next? So yeah, so we decided we wanted to emphasize the first couple of hits on it. So we've got another version of Massive here, basically, just playing them first few hits, just the low hits. Again, really simple sound coming out of Massive. just that, but then the homicide kind of like really inflating it and making it big again. EQs, taking the bottom off again, bit of reverb on it to give it a bit of space, a couple more EQs. So I've got one EQ knocking the bottom end off and then another one later on, putting it back on again by the looks of things. So yeah, there's that. Another thing I do sometimes is bounce out my sounds as audio. Just because the processing and stuff you can do on, often you come up with different, you do different things basically, you put your head in a different place and you kind of, yeah, just sort of come up with different results. So I bounced that out as audio, I think probably without the delays and stuff on. And then what I did is once I got it back in here as audio, I then just pitched it down, did a pitch shift on it, down by 12, down by an octave, just to add a bit more sort of bottom end to it really. So that's without it on. And then with it on again. I think it's probably going back through all them delays again as well to kind of tie it together with that sound. So that's taken us to that. No, that. And then another thing I do, especially on these sort of percussive, sort of fast, sort of hitty riffs, is use white noise doing the same rhythm. So kind of just adds a bit more grit and just really helps it sort of cut through the mix. So often one of the things I use for that is Predator. It's just what I've always used for white noise. Just simple white noise. Doing the same rhythm. I mean, it's not got the changes in the riff, it's just all on one note. And then what we've got here, again, this is the Own Boys. It's basically using that again like a sample delay. So I'll basically have the original signal panned over to one side and then the first tap of the delay on it panned over to the other side with just like a few samples sort of timing on it basically, which kind of just makes the sound appear wide for some reason. I don't quite know why it does it. So that's it without it on. And then with it on, just sort of opens it up really. And there's a little bit of delay on that. And so that's all, that's then layered up with all these parts are then grouped together again into this channel, all leads. And then there's a load more plugins on it again, mainly delay ones by the looks of things. I mean, for this sort of riff, like quite a few of my things have got this sort of riff and the delays are really important on it to get it sort of really, really sort of bounce in the mix. And one of my favorite delays is Echo Boy, which is just brilliant. The sound to Echo Boy, it's just got a really good analog sound to it and it really gets stuff out really wide as well. And there's a good saturation on the delay that you can use here as well. It's just really, really sort of thicken the sound up. And yeah, that just really makes it sort of bounce. Couple more delays, a little ping pong delay on there, more EQs, and then Fab Filter Saturn, which is another distortion thing, just on, that's on all these channels together. At the end of the final plugin I've got on it is that, which really just brings out that top end a bit more and just gives it all, the whole thing a bit more grit and sort of ties it all together a bit more. And so yeah, that's kind of how that sound's made up really. But I mean, a lot of my tracks are made up with this sort of sound and it's really important. You can't really get like the attack and the warmth and everything out of one sound is really hard. And so layering up sounds is really important to get that sort of sound really.
And what about working with the vocals and stuff? Was it a bounce mix that you got for vocal or did you treat the vocal?
It looks like they sent us pretty, yeah, the vocals sounded great already, you know, so we didn't really do anything to them. A little bit of EQ, bit of reverb and stuff, but obviously they were beautifully recorded already. Couple of light effects parts we did do on it, was a preverb that I did on it basically, just to introduce it. But yeah, didn't really touch the vocals at all, to be honest.
And what about the arrangement compared to the original?
Well, like I say, we sort of tried loads of different things and had sort of the chords and stuff from the original. I think at some point we had this as the groove and then it dropped into sort of the original parts and stuff. And then back into this groove again. But I think we accidentally dropped the vocal over the groove, I think. And it kind of really worked. So we just kind of got rid of all the music in the break and just went with it being a banger and just kind of with the whole groove really. So again on here, using these on my main output about the EQ, like in the build on the last track I showed you where I was automating the bottom end off. In this, it kind of just cuts off. you listen here, and just going along. So a lot of it, and I mean, I do this in quite a lot of tracks, just knock the whole bottom end off to keep it rolling. Rather than doing a break where it just sort of stops completely, I'll often just take all the bottom end off the main loop that's in there, so it just keeps rolling sort of thing. And then obviously you've got that then to bring back in again. And you'll see it jump back down there again. And it's something that I use quite a lot on a lot of my stuff, so yeah, it's pretty important with my sound. So another element of this track in the build on it is the pitching vocal, which I use, kind of make a rise out of the reverbed end part of the vocal. Now luckily the vocal they sent has already had a reverb section on it at the end of it, so it's pretty easy to do. So this was the original vocal. Went into that reverb sort of part basically. So what I did is I took that and then just using the pitch shift on, just it's in Cubase I think it was. Yeah, it would have been. Because you can do, as well as being able to transpose, you can also do an envelope pitch shift. So, yeah, you basically just draw it in, the sort of amount you want, and you put in the amount of semitones you want to go up, and then just get it to do that, process that. If this isn't going to take too long. And yeah, so this is an element in this track quite a lot. It's a good thing to do. Good thing for making, to make rises out of vocals is quite good anyway, because it's just a good sort of texture, do you know what I mean? As well as sort of the normal sort of synth rises. A nice sort of vocal gives you a different texture. It's going to take forever now, but looks, I know, is it done? Yeah, so if you listen to it now, I'll put the pitch shift on that part. So it does that basically, and I then put that on another channel so I could EQ it and put it through the side chain. And then another thing I did is I then duplicated that track again, the part I'd made that had the pitch bend on it. Duplicated that again, pitched it down by 12, and put that in there as well, just to give it a bit more body to it sort of thing. It's something that I do quite a lot. This is one of the things I was saying about bounce stuff to audio. Often a good way of thickening stuff up is to get it bounced out, put it back in again, pitch it down by 12, pitch it up by 12 or 5 or 7 or whatever, just to give you, just to thicken it up. I do that quite a lot on quite a lot of different tracks. Okay, so the next thing I'm going to show you is my remix from last year of Francesco Rossi Paper Aeroplane, which was this one. Now I'm just going to go through some of the parts that make this up. Just play it from early on. Also the vocal's amazing, didn't really do a lot to that. Great vocal, I was really, really happy when I got asked to remix it, because I'd heard it before out in Ibiza and yeah, just knew I could do something really good with it, so I was really excited about doing it. So I'll just mute them for now. Just look at the main groove, what's sort of making up the main groove. So these drums, these were from the original, these were on the original loops that they sent me. Let's try to find how it was originally. Yeah, I think that's the loop they sent me originally. So again, did a bit of sort of EQing and stuff on it, a bit of distortion, Fab Filter Saturn used on that. Kind of bring out the sort of mid-range of it, adds a bit of distortion sort of in that mid-range to sort of, yeah, to kind of bring it all out. Envelope Shaper again, just to bring out the transients a little bit in there, because it's quite sort of soft, the drum and stuff, so I wanted to sort of give it a bit more sort of bite on some of the hits. Loads of EQs again, putting stuff on, taking stuff off, taking the same thing off, putting the same stuff back on again by the looks of things. This is another EQ that's with Cubase, which I often use for just bringing the real high top ends out. And that, another EQ, so tons of EQs as normal. So yeah, that was the loop. And then basically in order to get it in the groove a bit tighter, I just chopped part of it. So probably just like the first beat or two or three beats, no, probably two or four beats of it. And then just loop that basically, put it through the side chain again so it ducks down when the kick's in. Kick again with the white noise. So that was that. Then just offbeat hi-hat running out of contact. and this part, which is one of the main sort of signature sounds from it. Again, simple sound to start with, really. Let's turn all this off. It's just a bongo sound from just a percussive sound out of a sample CD or something, just a very simple pattern that I put in. Just turn the sidechain off. So yeah, started off as that basically. So then it's then sent to the sidechain channel to duck it out of the way of the kick, like that. And then started piling a load of effects on it. Fab filter Saturn to start with again. Just added a bit of grit to it. Rocket compressor. Rocket compressor, which really absolutely hammering with that and just really sort of bringing it out. Envelope editor again. I mean, I use the envelope editor in a different way this time, because if you hear the transients on this are already like really, really loud. So rather than using it to make the transients more attacky, you can actually use it the other way to actually take it down a little bit to make it softer. Because I mean, it was clashing a little bit with the kick, and it was just the transients were just so loud, it was just really poking through the mix and sounded a bit messy. So I used that to kind of tame that down a little bit. Load of EQs again, standard EQs from Cubase. And the Sonox ones, which I use quite a lot. If the Cubase ones aren't really cutting it, the Sonox ones are normally what I go for. And then the thing, just like with the Swedish House Mafia remix, one of the things that makes this sound really bounce is a delay on it. Again, it's Echo Boy. So it just gives it that nice wide sort of spread and just gives it a bit of space and a bit of, I don't know, just makes it sound a lot better, really, a lot bigger and a lot sort of wider. So that's then starting there with the kick and the white noise, drums, the offbeat hat. Then there's the bass that sort of sits underneath it. Now I think this is probably again off the, yeah, I've still got it here, off the Mini Moog again. So it's the same pattern. I mean, some of the notes were sort of overlapping and stuff, so I found it every so often some of the notes would jump out like there at the end and there. And one of the other things with the Mini Moog is it kind of moves around a little bit, the sound sort of moves around. So one of the things I do quite a lot of this is bounce it out and then just take audio, the best one really, do you know what I mean? So that it's, especially when you're EQing stuff, to really get that EQ bang on, you need the sound to be the same each time, do you know what I mean? So I basically bounce that out as audio and found the best bit and just loop that basically. So it's probably just like a two beat loop. Yeah, it's just a two beat loop. Nah, that's, what's that doing? That's not really doing a lot of that. So yeah, so there's that. But then also, if you remember when I played the original bass sound, there was a few notes that sort of opened up and I quite liked some of them. Because it was a bit random, I couldn't obviously use the original thing. So I basically bounced them out as well and put them on another channel. If I can find them here, bass one. So it's just that basically. So I stuck a few of them in sort of the odd sort of place and then put that with the other part. So that you get a few hits of that every now and then, but I had a lot more control over them now because they were audio. And they sit in there like that. You hear they just hit every now and then. Turn the So yeah, that's how I kind of did the bass in it. Back on. And then obviously the great vocal just then just kind of stuck right over the top of it. So another thing that I often do is put in, I've used this sound on a few different things just to kind of layer stuff up. It's got a really good attack on it, so it just kind of adds a bit of pace to it, a bit of pace to things. So that's just kind of running in there. Just kind of picks it up a little bit. And then a few different rises that I think, I'm not sure what I made these out of. again, done the same thing here where I pitched it down. I had this rise that I'd made out of something or other. Put in another version of it, pitched it down by 12. Sticking it up. Or maybe more than 12, actually. No, down by 12. Yeah, some interesting rise sounds. And then you've got this coming out of Massive, which sounds really weird on its own and all that tune, but sits quite nicely in there once it's with the other stuff. Again, I think I used the same thing on my master out, where I knocked the bottom end off again for the bills. So all the bottom end comes off there. And then there's the kind of main lead sound, which is this. Once again, really, really simple sound. Doing that same pattern that I had that original perk sort of sound on the bass line doing. That's it without the sidechain on. So I got this out of Massive. Again, really simple sounds, just a saw, the unison on it. One of the things that's good in Massive here is the unison thing on here, so it'll play like sort of multiple like versions of the same sound. So this is one sound, it's obviously very mono, so I wanted to get it out quite a lot wider. So I put the unison up to two, so you've got two of the same sound playing. But then one of the other things you can do that's really good is them two signals, you can actually split them so that they one plays out of each speaker effectively. And that's this pan position thing here. So that's it with them being mono, and then if you move this out, it kind of takes them out wide to give it a lot more width. There's the saw, then there's another layer on the other oscillator, which is just one of the mental like sort of waveforms that they've got on here, layered up with that saw. And then I think I'm using the white noise on it again here as well, which is here. Just to add a little bit of bite to it the same way I did with the audio white noise on some of the other parts. And then just start piling on the processing again. So EQ knocking the bottom end off. A bit more EQs, doing various bits and pieces, just changing the sound. And then the Echo Boy again, which with this really adds to the sound. It kind of really opens it up. Just gives it that reverb-y sort of size. And then a load of distortion. This time the distortion is actually coming after the Echo Boy, so it really, really brings it all out, makes it a lot harsher. I mean, it's just a really simple, it's the overdrive plugin from, I think it's probably on an even earlier version of Cubase, like this was from original. I had to actually get the DLL file and put it into here in order for me to carry on using it because I was so stuck in my ways using it. So I still use it quite a lot. And that takes it from that to that, just adds like loads more grip to it. And then that's just kind of put in there with all the other parts again, really. So I put in the perk part, which adds the mid-range to it, and then bass, which adds a sub to it. Oh no, I've got the side chain back on again. A bit weird. And then back in there again. Again, it's quite similar to Rocket in that it's just made up of, it's all about that continuous build through the whole track. Loads of different rises, all just kind of rising really. The white noise thing again I did with the bandpass coming up. And then just all about knocking that bottom end off with it and back in again and just sort of like marrying that with the vocal and stuff really for the impact. That's about it on that one, mate, really.